Yup. Another laser cutter. I know, but this P2 by xTool is different. It comes with a handful of fancy features, including the ability to map a curved surface and engrave in 3D. That's something I haven't seen from any other CO2 laser cutter, and it got me pretty intrigued, so I had to try it out. I also recently got this mini carver from Arbortech, which lets me effortlessly carve wood. I realized these two tools in combination could make a pretty powerful duo, so that's what I'm getting into today. I'll be showing you the process of setting up this P2 laser cutter and using it to make a really cool project using that 3D engraving feature. I'm pretty excited, so let's get right into it. Here it is, the xTool P2 55-watt laser cutter. It's got the same general footprint and form factor of the other CO2 laser cutters I've tried out so far, though I do like the sleek, dark theme. It arrived well packed and protected, so despite being delivered on its side, everything was still in order. The machine is 40 inches wide and weighs 100 pounds, so a helping hand is a good idea to move it around, but besides that, unpacking was mostly straightforward, and xTool provides a very clear and simple setup guide to get started. While mostly plug and play, the P2 does require you to fill up the water tank that cools the laser, and the only hurdle I really hit was trying to remove the back cover that reveals the laser tube. For some reason, it really didn't want to slide off, and I was a bit worried about breaking something, but eventually I got it loose. So here's the 55-watt laser tube, which was perfectly intact, and on the right side here we have the water tank. The P2 comes with a funnel as well as this antifreeze, but since we don't get freezing temperatures in my region, we can fill the tank entirely with distilled water, which is the one additional thing I had to purchase. The guide specifies how much water to add before turning on the machine, which starts that water filling the laser tube, after which we can top off the water tank and close everything up. Finally, we'll connect the exhaust hose and we're good to go. I haven't got the xTool fume extractor yet, so I just stuck the hose into the venting system from my xWake Cloud Pro laser for now. It doesn't have any filters, but it sucks pretty well. Then I connected the P2 to my laptop via USB cable. You can also connect by Wi-Fi and other means, but I like having a direct offline connection. The laser also comes with some cardboard, acrylic, and basswood sheets to get started, so we'll use those for some quick test cuts. Instead of the traditional honeycomb bed, we've got these removable slats and some springy clips that connect to them for holding down our material. It's a nice little system. Now let's take a look at the xTool Creative Space software. I can refresh the wide-angle camera to get a full view of the build area, and there's also an automatic measuring feature, which didn't get me a totally accurate measurement in this case, but let's just roll with it. Next, I'll import my design, which I had exported as a DXF file from Adobe Illustrator, and the software recognized the different layers, which is cool, but the various outlines of my illustration were all separated, so I had to use the built-in combination tools to subtract the inner outlines from the outer one in order to get the correct image. I've since learned that an SVG file does import properly combined, so I'll do that going forward. Anyways, from here I tried to find the basswood settings for the engraving, but it wasn't showing up. So I was about to do some test circles and ended up on this different menu, which did have the basswood settings. So forget that, I'll just go straight for my own design. You should pretty much always run test cuts when using a new material, but I was feeling ballsy, so with my drawing set to engrave and the outline set to cut, I clicked start, which leads to this preview, and then I'll click start once more to actually send the job to the machine. Now I can bonk the button to start it up, and off it goes. The entire piece here took 8 minutes, and I think it came out very well. There are some slight burn marks around the cut, but the built-in air assist works to minimize that, and you can always mask the surface with tape or masking film to reduce that further. Next up, I threw in some 3mm acrylic to cut a quick base. The P2 has this nice display to show progress, and this cut was done in about 30 seconds. Again, I just used the default settings and it worked flawlessly. Considering that I just jumped into the xTool software without reading any instructions and managed to pull this off first try was pretty satisfying, and I just love the subtle depth effect that these engravings have. I also decided to engrave a quick Make Anything logo on the back to test out some smaller details. I did forget to switch back to the basswood settings, and I didn't group the shapes, so they all engraved one at a time, which was pretty inefficient, but the end result came out looking good all the same. Super cool! Being able to pull off this test without any extra calibration is certainly a victory for the P2 laser cutter, but now it's time for a more significant project that will really put this machine to the test for an actual business application, and to use that fancy 3D curve engraving feature. My sister's wedding is coming up next month, and I was asked to make some numbers to help guests find their tables. That could be something as simple as making little signs like our scooter fly here, but for my dear sister, I had to do something a little extra. My plan for this project is to get some wooden logs and hollow them out so they have a smooth inner surface while retaining the live bark on the outside. Then I'll use the P2's 3D curve feature to scan the concave surface and engrave the numbers thereupon. Here are the logs I plan to use. I chose to go with the pine ones on the left over the oak, since it's much less dense and should be easier to work with. So I began measuring and marking off sections of that pine, aiming for pieces that are roughly 5 to 6 inches tall, and trying to capture the more interesting pieces of bark on the outside as well. Now we'll head over to the bandsaw where I can make the rough cuts to get our individual pieces. Of course, I am trying to make nice straight cuts, but I'll also be sanding these sides flat later on, so it doesn't have to be perfect. I can also start to trim off any branches sticking out, and then I'll start carving away the center of the logs. These cuts are definitely precarious, being quite tall and having the wood grain running vertically in a way that they could unintentionally split. So I was very slow and careful here, assuming that the wood might break off at any moment. Thankfully, nothing went haywire, and I still have all my fingers. Here are all the pieces I made, and a couple actually did split after cutting, so I'll just go ahead and use wood glue to stick those back together, along with silicone bands and some weight to apply pressure while they dry. Speaking of drying, while these logs did dry outdoors for several months, I wanted to make sure to kill any mold and bugs that might still be growing on them, so I used my filament dryer to further cure the wood. I left them in there for several hours at 70 degrees Celsius, which should do the trick. After that, I did a bit of cleanup on the bark, breaking off any loose bits, and brushing away as much dirt and dust as I could. I am going for a natural look here, but I still want things to be relatively clean. Okay, time for some carving fun with the Arbortech Mini Carver and this Mini Pro carving blade. I clamped the pieces down with some packing foam for protection, hooked the carver up to my shop vac, and carefully started shaping the wood. My goal was to make these pieces about half an inch thick, so I just carved away while pinching the wood now and then to gauge the thickness. I'm really glad I went with this softer pine because it carved away super easily, and I didn't run into any issues. Each piece took about 5 minutes, and I was having fun the whole time. Next, it's time to sand, and the Mini Carver can do that as well. It comes with 3 grits of sandpaper, and I started with the middle 180 grit discs, since my pieces are already fairly smooth. This was my first time using the sanding attachment for the Mini Carver, and I guess I was a bit careless because I quickly thrashed the sanding disc. So going forward, I was more deliberate with my strokes, and I didn't run into any more problems with that for the rest of the pieces. As with my last woodworking project, I did have a few pieces with beetle holes, so this time I soaked those with super glue before sanding them down a bit further. This thin Starbond glue absorbs into the wood really well. Now it's time to sand the ends of the wood, which I'll do using this belt sander with an 80 grit belt. I just manually oriented the parts until the top and bottom edges were completely flat, making sure that the pieces could stand upright on their own. While I was at it, I also flattened the ends of any branches on the back. With that, my pieces are nice and smooth, with just a tiny bit of hand sanding at the end to clean up my edges before it's off to the laser cutter. Here we are at the xTool P2, where I can remove these slats to make room for my curved pieces. But first, I am going to start with a small sample piece, since I don't have too many spare parts. I'll be using adhesive putty to hold my pieces in place, and I intentionally angled this piece to try out the curve measuring feature. I also printed this quick adapter for my air extraction fan to hopefully make it a bit more efficient. Now let's head back into the xTool Creative Space software, where I'll switch to the curve process mode and then click curve measure, which brings up this box to prepare our 3D scan. These arrows let you move the laser head along with this red laser dot, which will move to the top left corner of our material and mark it as vertex 1. Then we'll move down to the opposite corner and mark that vertex 2. Once those points are marked, we'll click next and then start measuring. With that, the laser moves in a grid across the material, measuring all these individual points, which it then uses to create a mesh surface that represents our piece. I have found that you do want a slight margin around the edge of the material for a successful scan, and 8 millimeters generally seems to work well. We'll click done to return to the main screen, which highlights the area that we just scanned. Now I can bring in an SVG file and scale it to fit on our test piece. We'll set the mode to engrave, and to start out, I just guessed some power settings. We can also click on this little icon to bring up our mesh, and then we can click this map button to see our preview on the 3D surface. So the P2's built-in cameras don't work for this 3D engraving mode, but since we've mapped out the entire part, we can still see that the engraving here will be more or less centered. Everything looks good, so we'll send our job to the machine. And it turns out 40% power is pretty strong for this material, engraving nearly 10 millimeters deep in one pass and producing a lot of flame. So I quickly put an end to that and adjusted the power down to 6%, along with lowering the resolution, and that produced a much more reasonable result. As you can see, in this 3D engraving mode, the top speed is much slower than the standard engraving, which I'm guessing is a software limitation based on the Z movement that would have to happen for more dramatic curves. This process is in beta, so maybe we will get a bit of a speed boost with future software updates, but the most important thing is that the end result looks really good. The engraving came out very dark and clean, and I was happy with these settings. So it's time to go straight for the full size numbers. I'll continue using that putty to hold the wood in place, and I also temporarily used the slats to align the piece with the XY grid of the machine. Once again, I ran through the curve measurement process for this piece, and the preview came out looking really accurate. So I lined up my number and used the same settings from my last test, except I lowered the resolution to 100 lines per centimeter, which will speed up the job a bit and shouldn't affect the outcome much since this is a fairly large and simple engraving. One final preview to make sure everything looks good, and off we go. Our first number came out great. It's a very clean engraving, the positioning was perfect, so it's straight on to the next one. One after the next, each piece came out looking wonderful. Even without the camera preview, I was still able to position the graphics, and I perfectly concealed the crack in this wood knot, which was awesome. We can see a bit of resin escaped from the wood around that knot, but that's hardly visible to the naked eye. Also, on some of my most curved pieces, the software did give me a warning, but I just ignored that and it still worked out. Just barely, but it worked nonetheless. I also ended up wanting to trim some of the edges to make the pieces a bit more narrow. So for those, I just took a knife and a hammer and kind of broke off the ends by going along the grain of the wood. While that probably could have gone poorly, I was happy with the results. In fact, I managed to make all 12 numbers without any failures. So I was even able to make an extra sign for the bride and groom. Again, I was maxing out the steepness here, but once again, it just barely worked. This piece took the longest to engrave at just over an hour. My final step was to dust off any ashes hanging onto the pieces using the air compressor. For a more permanent piece, I would have used some kind of clear coat for preservation, but since these are only meant for one special day, I left the wood raw. That's actually nice because these pieces will be usable for compost or firewood after they've served their purpose. All right, here is my grand collection of numbers, and I could not be more happy with the results. This has been one of the most painless projects I've done in a long time, with nearly everything going according to plan. As I hoped, the Mini Carver and P2 Laser Cutter combo was exactly what I needed to pull these off, and I think they look great. Still, I've just barely scratched the surface of what that xTool P2 Laser Cutter can do, so if you liked this video and want to see future projects, make sure you're subscribed, and check out the links in the description to learn more about the tools I used today. That's it for today's video, so I'll see you in the next one. And as always, take care and stay inspired.